Today, I wanted to shift gears a little bit from what we've been discussing in earlier lectures, and I wanted to start discussing about permission blockchains. Till now, we've essentially focused on Satoshi Nakamoto's idea of proof of work, which was for permissionless blockchains. And in permissionless blockchains, any number of people could join. They could sort of join and leave at any time. So any number of people could participate in consensus. Okay, they could join and leave at any time. And of course, the nodes didn't have any fixed identity. So this was a very powerful idea, and really it's hardly a little over 10 years old. Credit goes to Satoshi Nakamoto for coming up for a consensus protocol for permissionless blockchains. So of course, distributed systems has been around for some time as a research area. From the 1980s at least, some pioneering work has been done. And people were looking at something called replicated state machines. So essentially, what you have is a situation like this, where you have a client and it wants to talk to a server. And get a reply. So let's say that there's a request. And a reply. So this is a usual client-server model, but now we want this server to be replicated. So it's not a single server. So let's say that there are several of these. And whatever state is there on the, let's say, one particular server should be replicated elsewhere. Okay, so these are all the rest of them. Let's say that this is the main server. And these are all of these are copies. Okay, so it should look to the client as if there is a single server. You know, it sends a request, it gets the correct reply, whatever as expected. But the state which is stored on this machine should be replicated in multiple places. Okay, and so effectively this is a distributed system where you have multiple machines and together they form one particular system. So people were analyzing these sorts of systems for several decades before Satoshi Nakamoto came onto the scene. And maybe Satoshi was one of those researchers because he seems to know a lot about distributed systems and security and so on. But why would we want this sort of a replicated state machine? So you might think about it. Why would we want an RSM? So why would we want copies of something, right? And all of us, I mean, we usually take copies of files. You might back it up to the cloud, you know, Google Drive or Dropbox or something like that, instead of just having it on your laptop. And the reason we do that is because there could be crashes. And we want whatever we have to be crash tolerant. Okay, so if your laptop goes down, you don't want that to be the end of your semester, right? All your, let's say you've written all your code for various projects and various courses on your machine. You don't want it to be dependent on your laptop, because if the laptop crashes, then you want to just be able to use another laptop, another machine, and keep going. So one way to do this is to have copies of your data in different places, right? And that's one reason why you might want something like a replicated state machine, okay, in various situations. Right? So let's think of a spacecraft . So let's say you have a CPU, right, and it has some memory and it's doing some computation. And let's say, suppose it's a CPU at in your lab. And what happens if, suppose, there is a random flip in a bit? Okay, so let's say that there is a flip in a bit in the memory, or somewhere in some register, you know, in the CPU. What we're going to end up with is some sort of a mistake in the computation. And I mean, if it's for a experiment for your homework or something, maybe that's okay. I mean, you'll realize that something has gone wrong and you would rerun it. But if such a thing happens in a spacecraft, then we are in big trouble, because the spacecraft is in outer space. There is no human being over there operating on it. Let's say it's an unmanned spacecraft. And an error like this could make the whole space mission collapse. Right? So this is very dangerous. So they might have a replicated state machine there. They might have multiple CPUs. Many of them, right? Okay, so these are all doing the same task. They are all supposed to be identical, right? And they are all given the same input, let's say, and they perform the same task, right? They run the same programs. And so then what is the spacecraft supposed to do here? So you might think, what would you do if you had to design such a system, right? Because maybe, so the assumption is here is that the bit flip or some sort of an error doesn't happen everywhere, right? So I mean, maybe a cosmic ray or something hits one of the CPUs and a bit flips, right? And maybe one of them is faulty, one of them gives some error, but that's fine. And what we might do is just look at the majority. So whatever output is given by the majority, the spacecraft will take as the final answer. Okay, and you might have a replicated state machine next. So there are, of course, other uses, like Google, for example. Google has your Gmail or your Drive and so on. It has it somewhere in the cloud, right, on some server. And they want to be crash tolerant, because if a customer finds that his data is suddenly gone, then he's going to bring the roof down. He's going to publish on WhatsApp, whatever, Twitter and everything, that Google is good for nothing, right? You should never use it because my data disappeared. So Google, of course, also wants to have copies of data. So anybody's data, so Google has their own file system, GFS, and I mean, there are other things like Hadoop and so on, right? And all of them want to have some sort of replication because they want to be crash tolerant. What if a machine goes down, right? So if this copy is lost due to some reason, then you at least have other copies, right, which you can use. So of course, if all of them go down, then we are in trouble, right? I mean, so we have to have some sort of a failure model, and we would want to be tolerant to that, some kinds of failures, right? And so distributed systems, researchers have looked at various failure models, and they looked at how to achieve consensus for various failure models. So today I wanted to talk about one particular paper called RAFT, which looks at a particularly simple failure. Various blockchains or freely available blockchains, they claim to have implemented RAFT, you know, as a consensus protocol. Okay, so it's worth studying this. RAFT. So RAFT is a paper by Ongaro and Osterhout. And I've uploaded it to Moodle. Diego Ongaro. And John Ooster. So this came out not so long back, actually 2014. And essentially it's somewhat easy to understand consensus protocol for a permission system. Okay, so we want a permission system. So unlike Satoshi's system where anybody could join and they didn't need to have any identities, here you have some N servers. Okay, and let's say that all of them have an identity and they can sign messages. Okay. So of course in a general permission system each server can sign, you know, it has a digital key, let's say a public private key pair, and it can identify itself. So of course RAFT doesn't look at very sort of strong failure models, or it doesn't look at malicious attackers and so on, but each node can identify itself. It doesn't necessarily have to sign with a key as such. Right, so maybe let's say it puts a number in its message which identifies which particular server it is. So we have a replicated state machine, okay, composed of these N servers. And let's say that particular server has a log of inputs. So this log is just a set of records of the input given by the client, right? So the client might say set x equal to 3, set y equal to 1, right? Set y equal to 9 and so on, right? And the state machine, let's say, just stores the values of these variables. Okay, and so let's say that it has the latest state 0 or so, right? And the state machine should correspond to the inputs here. And there are other servers which with logs. Okay, and ideally you would want copies of everything across all the servers, right? But we have to look at situation where something might go wrong, and in which case, how do we sort of ensure that all of them have agree on the same set of logs and let's say the state machine. Okay, so this is very, these logs are very similar to a blockchain. I mean, it's in a blockchain we get the inputs as sort of transactions from users and we order them in a blockchain, right? So here we are getting inputs from the clients and we are putting them in an order in the log. Okay, so there's no need to have a blockchain sort of structure where you have hash and so on of the previous block. Okay, but you just, let's just assume that they are stored in some particular order. Okay, and we don't necessarily have to have a blockchain. But of course you could use Raft for a blockchain, I mean, just to achieve some sort of consensus. So in Raft, what is the failure model? So the failure model says that a node can fail and stop. So any server can just stop working at some particular point in time. Okay, and from there on, let's say it doesn't revive. So this is called the fail-stop model, and it doesn't take malicious nodes into account. So I mean a node is not trying to do any mischief by sending wrong messages or anything like that, but we are allowing for a node to fail. Okay, something like you know, the machine crashes at some time, right? And we still want the system to be robust to these sorts of failures. So the question is, what do we do if a node fails, right? How do we take care of it? So let's look at what a node might have. And so let's say there's a client, and the client can send first of all a request. And besides this particular server, there are other servers. Okay, let's say this is server 1, and this is server 2, and so on. So there are several of these servers. So what Raft is going to do is, first of all, let's say that there's a consensus module. So the request comes in, and first it's going to send, there's going to be some communication with these servers, these other servers. Let's say that this is the leader. And of course, let's say that this client is sending the request not just here, let's say it's sending it everywhere. Okay, let's say that there's a broadcast medium and all the servers get the request. Okay. So First, this leader has to achieve consensus with the other nodes. Okay, so first of all, the request comes in. Let's say consensus takes place, and after that, let's say after this, if consensus has been achieved, the request is written to the log. Okay, so we have these various requests, and the state machine is updated. And once the state machine has been updated, we can reply back to the client. Okay, so let's say that this happens, and let's say that this is number 4. Okay, well, let's say this is 4 and this is 5. Okay, so just to repeat, the client sends a request, and when it gets a reply, this whole system should behave as if there's a single server without any error, right? And so the reply that comes back should be like as if a single server is behaving properly. But in the meantime, this leader has to communicate with the other servers, and before it sort of decides that that particular request has been accepted and it can update its log and state machine. Okay, so why does it have to first communicate with other machines before actually committing this particular request to its log? Okay, so let's think about that. So let's say, why consensus? First. So suppose the client has sent a request to the leader, and suppose the leader replies before talking to the other servers. So let's say that it updates the log and the state machine. Let's say that this happens first, and it replies, and then suppose in the fourth step it communicated with the other servers. So is this a good thing to do? And you might see very clearly why it's not a very good thing to do. Because what, suppose that before this fourth step, the leader fails. Okay, so suppose the leader fails after 3. Then what's going to happen? So the client has sent a message, and let's say it's got a reply, and then the leader collapses, and the state hasn't been updated in other servers. Okay. Now this is a very serious problem, because other servers don't know what to do. I mean, has that request been committed or not? You know, so we will have to sort of choose somebody to be a new leader to replace this old leader. And that new leader might be confused, you know, where it won't know whether that request has been committed or not by the original leader, right? Whereas the client thinks that that has been committed. Okay, so this is a very tricky thing, because the request may not have been committed over here at the other server. So what we should do is, first we should achieve consensus among them, and then only then reply to the client. Okay, and then we are sort of robust to the leader failing. Even if the leader fails, the state has been updated elsewhere. And so if a new server is elected as a new leader, I mean it can do the job of sending a reply, okay, which corresponds to this request. Okay, so essentially we want to do things in this order. First, the leader is going to communicate with other servers in order to achieve consensus. And then it will reply back to the client. So what RAF does, it splits the problem into two parts. Okay, so first of all, it takes care of leader election. So it chooses a new leader if the current one, let's say, fails. And secondly, it does log replication. So ideally we want the log to be the same at all the servers. So the leader accepts log entries from clients and replicates them across the cluster. So leader accepts log entries from clients and replicates them across the cluster of servers. Okay, and by doing this, it forces the others to agree to its own log. So we'll have to see how this is done. Whatever we do has to be robust to the leader failing, right? Or maybe even some other node failing. And we are not allowing arbitrary malicious behavior where a node can send any message to confuse others. Okay, that's a more challenging problem. And once we've discussed RAF, we'll talk about PBFT. And PBFT handles a more general situation like that. Okay, so let's see how to choose a leader. So the leader's job is to take requests from the client, right? And it's sort of acting as that single server when it sends, gets requests and it sends replies back to the client. Okay? And so somebody has to be chosen a leader. When you sort of switch on the machines, somebody has to be selected as the leader. And the question is, how are we going to do this? Okay, so let's look at a sort of state diagram for a node. So first of all, a node starts up. Let's say a particular server starts up, and initially it is a follower. Okay, so it's not a leader. By follower I mean a node other than a leader. So we switch on, somebody just wants to start this replicated system. So he just comes and he switches on the machines, all of them, you know, at some particular times. Okay, maybe not all at once. So every node initially says that I am not the leader, I am a follower. Okay, and it waits, and it waits to see whether it hears another leader or not. Okay. So suppose it does not hear another leader, and so it starts a timer, a random timer, and if a timeout occurs, it says that I am a candidate for a leader. Okay, so you might think, why doesn't it just call itself the leader, right? I mean, what might happen over there? Well, you might have a situation where multiple people sort of become leaders, right? If you just have a timeout based, what if the timers are almost the same, or they expire at almost the same time? Then two people might become leaders, and that causes confusion, right? So we would want only a single server to be elected or to designate itself as the leader. Okay, so if a timeout takes place, then that particular node says I am a candidate, and it announces that it is a candidate. Okay, so the terms used here are the American terms for elections. Like right now we have a presidential election going on there, and you have two candidates, two main candidates, right? And one of them is going to be elected, right? So they are these people. Let's say you may have multiple nodes which sort of declare themselves as being candidates just because the timer sort of expired at roughly the same time. And now what we are going to do is there's an election, and whichever candidate receives majority of votes, becomes the leader. Okay. And okay, so this is roughly what it looks like. And of course there are other situations. So let's say that somebody else gets more votes. I mean, somebody else was elected the leader. Okay, so if it discovers a new leader, it becomes a follower, right? Okay, and of course there are other tricky situations. Let's say that we look at those a little bit later, but okay, where there's something called a term, and we'll talk about this later. So let's say that there's another leader. So it may happen that some particular node, let's say it's a leader, and it, you know, the leader is supposed to send out heartbeat messages. It sends out messages saying, I am the leader, I am the leader. But in case the leader, I mean the other nodes don't hear a message from the leader for some time, they might think that the leader has failed, and they might volunteer to become a candidate, right, and may get elected as a new leader. So it may happen that somebody is a leader, but some of his messages have been delayed for some time, and so people mistook him as being failed node. So you may have somebody else getting elected as a new leader. Okay, and for that there is something called a term. Again, it's an American terminology. So a term, like Donald Trump has his first term now, right? And if he's elected again, then that's his second term. So term is like a variable which keeps getting incremented. Every time a new leader is elected, he increments the term. So if a leader finds that there is another new leader in the system who has a higher term, then he realizes that it's time for him to retire, and he can go back and become a follower. Right? So let's say he discovers leader with higher term. Okay, so this is roughly how the leader election takes place, and we look at some more details once we've discussed about log replication. Okay, so effectively we want only a single leader to be there in the system. So when a node first starts up, it says, okay, I'm a follower, let me just listen. And if it hears another leader, okay, so if it, let's say, hears a leader, then it remains a follower, it doesn't have to do anything. But if its timer expires, then it can decide that I want to become a new leader. Right? First he becomes a candidate, because it's possible that multiple people's timeouts might occur roughly at the same time. And then they announce, any node says, I am a candidate, right? And if he gets, and then they vote by sending out messages. And if the candidate has got majority of the votes, then he is the new leader. Okay, and here there is no malicious behavior like somebody voting for multiple people. Okay, so that's not part of the failure model. Okay, so all we allow is that a node can go down, right? But nobody is malicious. So every node, if it hears multiple candidates, it will only vote for one of them. Right? So we are guaranteed that only in case there are multiple candidates, you have only a single leader. Right? It's a simple enough system, and we look at the finer details a little bit later when we discuss about log replication. So one or two more things which we need to discuss in this state diagram. So here I've assumed that when somebody becomes candidate, that automatically somebody is going to be elected, right? But it may be possible that let's say that there are several candidates and none of them gets a majority of votes. So in that case, what happens? So according to the state diagram in the paper, there is another timer put over here, and if a timeout occurs, then essentially they go for another election, right? And of course, a new election means that the term would be incremented by one. Okay, so there's another minor point here. So somebody can go from candidate state to follower, either if he discovers a new leader or if there is a new term. Okay, so if there is an election for a new term, you know, somebody has volunteered and he says that I become a candidate for a new term, then the other candidates will just drop out. Okay. So that's about the basics about how a leader is elected. So we'll come back to this leader election in a short while. But first let's look at the concept of a term. So essentially a term is like a term of a particular leader in the US, right? And if a new leader has to come, then the term is going to increment by one. Okay, so suppose there were an old leader had term, let's say N, then when the next leader comes, the term will be n plus 1. Okay, so in rare cases it may happen that, let's say in term n plus 1, nobody got elected. Let's say that multiple candidates had, nobody got the majority of the votes just because there were too many candidates. And in that particular case, of course, the term might increment to n plus 2. Okay, so that may happen, but definitely once the leader of term N, let's say, stops, he fails, then term is going to increment to N plus 1, or it may go higher than that. Okay, so every leader puts his term in its messages. So every, let's say, node puts the term in its messages. Okay, so for example, what could the messages could be? A request to vote. Somebody becomes a candidate and says, you know, that I want to become a candidate, request to vote for me, right? Or a leader might send an append entry message. So these are types of messages, and the details you can get from the paper, which is there on Moodle. But essentially, when a leader sends out, or any node sends out a message, it will also include a term field, okay, and it will mention which term the message is for. Okay, and so let's just look at it over the timeline. So let's say that this is term one. And let's say initially there was an election, and this, there was normal operation here, there was no problem. The client, by normal operation I mean that the client sent requests, and of course the replicated state machine sent back replies to the client, okay, but they also took care of consensus over here in between, right? But let's say that the leader failed. And a new leader was, let's say, elected. Okay, and then there was normal operation and so on. So here the term became two. The term, you can think of it as being a variable kept locally in every machine, right? And every time there is a new election, they will increment their term, right? And of course, if somebody else announces a term higher than their term, then they will use that as the new term variable, right? Okay, so here term is equal to 3 and so on. Okay. So let's look a little bit at what the logs look like at different nodes. So the log has an index number, which is just it's just a number for the requests as they are lodged in the logs. Let's say request position in the log. The term, okay, that we've already discussed, and the client input, the request. Okay, so these are the three things that are there in the log. Let's just look at what it might look like. So some particular node at a server might have a log which looks like this. So the log index, let's say it's one, this is an example of the log. And let's say this is the term. And let's say in the first term we had 3 requests coming in, and the input looked like this: set x is equal to 3, y to be 1, y to be 9. And then let's say that the term changed, it became 2. And here let's say that the client sent x equal to 2, and let's say we moved on to 3 and so on, right? Like maybe here the leader failed, so we had to elect a new leader. And whatever instruction was given over here. So these are examples. So let's say this is at the first server. Okay, but and let's say this is at the leader in term 3, let's say. Okay, so this is the log of term 3 leader. Okay, so suppose this is the state. And let's say that these belong to the followers. So let's say that the followers have exactly the same index in the term. Okay. And let's say that one particular follower, let's say it had only these, okay, up to x equal to 0. So distributed systems are quite tricky because not everybody sees the same thing, right? And so let's say that some messages sent by this leader did not reach this particular follower. Okay, so okay, let's say that this all is at the leader. This is for one particular follower, and let's say another follower. Okay, so this is has another set. Let's say that he has the same inputs as the leader. And another one may have even less, right? Maybe it has only this much. So these are the various servers. Let's say this is server 1. This could be server 2, 3, and 4, and so on, right? And maybe they haven't, not all the servers have exactly the same inputs as the leader. So maybe some messages were lost or delayed, right? So we want to take care of these sorts of situations. And in case the leader fails for some reason, we want the system to continue in a correct fashion. Okay. So this might be a situation. So what has happened here is that the term has incremented because let's say the leader of term 1 and term 2 failed. This is currently what is there in the leader of term 3. He has been getting requests from clients and maybe he has put it in his input. And we are assuming that consensus has taken place appropriately. Okay. So it is possible that some messages which were sent by the leader to other nodes didn't reach them, because of which they have different inputs over here. Okay. So what we want, of course, is that everybody should have a subset of what the leader has. Okay, so this is what the leader has, and we would want everybody to have something less than what the leader has, right? I mean less than or equal to what the leader has. So the question, so finally what we want is that whenever the leader commits one of these inputs and he updates his just let me get this correct. Whenever he commits something in his input, that should be as if the global server, which sort of represents this entire replicated state machine, has committed. So let me write that down here. So let's just write that down. Committing inputs. So what we want is that if leader commits an input and let's say updates a state, then effectively the distributed system has committed that. Effectively, the replicated state machine, I should say, has committed this input. Okay. So if at all this leader has said that I'm sort of updating my latest state of X over here to 5 because of this last input, then effectively it must mean, the way RAF should work, it should guarantee that effectively the replicated state machine has committed to that input. That it means that even if this leader fails after this point, the next leader would be able to take this up. It would have the state corresponding to this particular input. So how can we ensure that? Okay, and so how to ensure this? Okay, so we want to ensure that if the leader commits an input, then overall the replicated state machine has committed. Okay, so how are we going to do that? I mean, it's a little bit of a tricky situation. Okay. So as we see over here, there is only one particular follower who has this input correspond, this last one over here, which I've shown, right? So it's a little bit tricky. How are we going to do this, right? So suppose this particular node, the leader commit, says that I'm committing this last input and he fails. And suppose this first follower shown over here, suppose this follower is going to become the next leader. Then he hasn't seen these inputs, these last two inputs. So as far as he is concerned, that the last input he received was x equal to 0. He didn't receive y equal to 7 and x equal to 5. So what is the replicated state machine state going to be? Right? So we want to ensure that if at all the leader commits x equal to 5, and then if he fails, then the next leader should be able to have that x equal to 5. In fact, everything from the beginning of the leader's log up to this x equal to 5 should be present at that new leader. Okay. So if leader fails, then new leader should have all inputs committed by old leader. And the question is, how are we going to do this? Okay, so Raft has a very interesting way of doing it. So let's look at this again. Okay. So what we are going to do is, we are going to use a majority rule. So we are going to say that the leader is going to commit something only if a majority of nodes in the network have got that input. Okay, so this leader, which I am showing over here in the red box, he is going to commit this x equal to 5 only if he has got replies from a number of followers that they have their logs everything starting from this x equal to 3 up to x equal to 5, which is there in his log. Right? Only then he is going to commit it. So he is going to first ensure that majority of people in the network are sort of up to date in their logs, that their logs are up to date and have everything equal to what he has in his log, and only then he is going to commit that last entry of his log, okay, and update his state machine. And in that case, if he updates his state machine, he will reply to the client with the appropriate reply. Okay, so is that good enough? Okay, that's something that we have to see. And in case a new leader has to be elected, whether that's going to solve the problem. Okay, so let's write that down. Rule one, let's say. A leader commits an input only after ensuring that a majority of nodes in the network have received that input, okay, and the log of these nodes is the same as the leader's, let's say as its own, up to this entry. Okay, so let's maybe look at an example so that it becomes clear. So this is the leader. Okay, and so the leader has various inputs, let's say x 3, y is 1, y is 9, x is 2, x is 0, y is 7, x is 5, and so on, let's say x is 4, right? And okay, let's say that the followers so of course the index is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on. Okay. And the followers inputs. Okay, so everybody should also have the same term. I mean, the terms in the logs should correspond to that of the leader. So you have 1, 1, 1, 2, let's say 3, and so on. Okay. So let's say that you have various followers, and they have, let's say that this particular follower has everything up to here, okay, And okay, so let's say that the leader is server 1 and this is server 2, server 3. Let's just server number here, and let's say 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and so on, right? Okay. And let's say that several of these have been updated. Okay, so the leader has got this entry x is equal to 4. So before committing, it sends this, it communicates with all the other followers and asks them whether they have got this particular entry, right? And once they confirm that they have got the entry and that their logs are exactly the same as what this particular leader has, okay, then it sort of counts how many of these have replied that way. So let's say that yeah, all of these have got everything. Okay, let's say we give one more. Okay, so it has ensured that more than half of the nodes in the network, let's say that there are 7 nodes, so definitely 4 more have got all the entries which are there in the leader's log. But let's say that some other node has got only a subset. Okay, and maybe this one has got even fewer than that, only up to here. Okay, it hasn't got all of these other entries. Okay, so even in this situation, maybe there is some delay in messages reaching nodes 6 and 7. The leader can now commit this entry. So it can commit this. Because more than half of the nodes in the network it knows has got this particular entry and everything else is the same as its log. Okay. So what it can do now is it can update its state machine based on this input x is equal to 4 and send an appropriate reply to the client. Okay. So why are we doing things this way? So now let's go a step further. So suppose this leader fails now. Okay, so this leader fails. Now we want a new leader to be elected who has all the entries in this log, because after all, this x equal to 4 has been committed and the state machine has been updated based on this. Right? So the state machine has effectively been updated by all these entries in the input of the old leader. So we want a new leader to be elected who also has the same state. So how are we going to do that? So which of these should be elected? So clearly we can see that the new leader should be one of these. Okay, so suppose this leader fails at this point in time. The new leader should be elected from one of these. Okay, so if one of these leaders is elected as the leader, I mean sorry, one of these followers is elected as the leader, then we are in business because it has the same state as the old leader and we can continue. So how are we going to do the new election? Okay, so we have to be a bit careful to ensure that only one of these is elected. Okay, so you might want to think for a moment how to do that. Okay, so suppose this leader fails. Okay, and the leader is supposed to be sending out heartbeat messages. Okay, so it's saying that I am alive. And let's say after some time, you know, no heartbeat messages are heard by any of these followers. So somebody can become a candidate. So let's look at a bad case. Okay, let's say that initially this one becomes the candidate. Okay, so one of those has decided to be candidate. Now it says that I am a candidate. So how are we to determine if it is one of those who has the updated state of the old leader? Okay. So one way to do that is that this node 6 should announce to everybody what particular log it has. Okay, so suppose it sends out its whole log. So it would send out that this is my log. Now, can it get majority of the votes? So we said anybody who gets majority of the votes gets, it becomes the leader. Okay. So Raft is going to be a bit clever. So it's not that you blindly vote. You vote for somebody only if his log is a superset, so to speak, of your own log. Okay. So number 7 can vote for number 6. So 7 can vote for 6 because his log is smaller, sort of it's included in the log that 6 sent out. He sees that, okay, 6 has sent out a log of size 6 and my own log has 4 entries which correspond to the 4 entries, the first 4 entries which were there in the log of 6. Okay, so number 6 can get one vote of number server number 7. Okay, but that's not enough for it to get elected as a new leader, because you need at least 4 votes in this scenario, or at least majority of the votes, let's say including your own vote for yourself, let's say everybody votes for himself, including your own vote you need at least 3 others. So in this case, candidate 6 is not going to get enough votes, so nobody is elected. Okay, and so then there's a timeout. And the term is incremented not just to 4, it's incremented by 1 more to 5. And now somebody else volunteers to become a leader. Okay? So let's say that node 7 volunteers to be leader in term 5, let's say. And of course, he's going to get 0 votes because nobody has a log which is a subset or at least equal to or subset of his own log. So he is not going to get enough votes, and we go to term 6, let's say, and let's say that one of these nodes, let's say volunteers, let's say this becomes a candidate, okay? And he sends out his full log. So all these other nodes, node 2, 4 and 5, they see that their logs are included in the log of sent out by number 3. So they vote for number 3, and number 6 and 7 also can vote for 3 because their logs are also subsets of or sort of prefixes of the logs sent out by this new candidate number 3. So candidate 3 can get votes from everybody, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7. So he gets majority of the votes and he is elected as the new leader. So now what does the new leader number 3 do? The new leader is going to see that some of the other nodes have logs which are much smaller than his own log. Okay. He sees that, okay, the lots of people have voted for me and they have logs same as mine, but some of the other nodes which are still alive, they have logs which are subsets of my logs. So what I am going to do is I am going to send them this information. So he sends them this information, okay, which correspond to these last 4 entries, and he updates them, right? So let's say I am just going to mark these. So node 7 updates his log. Okay, with the log information which was there in the new leader. Okay, and this other node doesn't have as much missing. So let's say that these last 2 entries are sent to number 6. Okay, and number 6 updates his log. So everybody has now the same log as everybody else, okay, the same entries. Okay, and so of course this new leader knows that this particular entry can be committed. Okay, he knows that the old leader would have committed this, okay, because he doesn't have to worry about it. Okay, and now the system can proceed with this. Okay, so you might want to think, how do we know for sure that this particular entry was committed by the old leader? Okay, so why would that have been the case? Well, because majority of nodes had got this particular entry and they had replied to the leader, right? So we know that the old leader would have committed this. Okay, so we don't have to worry about it, right? And we can proceed with accepting this particular entry. Okay, so there are two rules, effectively two main rules in Raft. So the first rule is that a leader commits an input only after ensuring that majority of nodes have received that input, and the log of these nodes is the same as it's known up to this entry. Okay. So that means that node leader 1, node number 1, who is the current leader in term 3, is going to commit x equal to 4 only if he has got replies from at least 4 nodes saying that they have a log identical up to his log till this entry x is equal to 4, okay, till and including this x equal to 4. Okay. And the second rule is the following. So vote for a candidate only if, or if and only if, your log is a prefix of the candidate's log. Okay. And these two rules ensure that if a leader goes down and a new leader is elected, then the new leader will have an updated log corresponding to the old leader's log, at least the log that he had committed. Okay, so it may happen, let's say that we look at these 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, so we had everything up to x equal to 4. And let's say that new input came in, and let's say x is equal to 6, okay, and let's say that everybody 2, 3, 4, 5 had everything up to x equal to 4, so this was committed. And of course, these had much smaller logs due to some reason. Maybe the messages didn't reach here or something like that. And right, so this is committed because majority have this. But then a new input came, and let's say even before this input could be sent to the other, to any of the followers, the leader failed. Before updating any follower. Okay. So now what has happened? So according to rule 1, this particular input has not been committed because it didn't send it to anybody, it didn't get replies from that many nodes. Right, So it hasn't committed it, okay? And let's say that it has failed. So now who is going to be elected as a new leader? Okay, so now we go through the leader election process, and again one of these is going to be elected. Okay, so these notes, maybe I haven't mentioned it till now, these notes are going to put something in their log only when they hear from the leader. Okay, so if the leader says put x equal to 6 in your log, they put it. Right, so that's a point that maybe I hadn't made clear earlier. Right? And so none of these have actually put this in their logs. So one of these is going to be elected, only one of these is going to get enough votes, okay, to be elected. Right? And so then that's fine because it has everything up till the last commit. Okay, so you can work out different examples and see what might happen. You know, what if only couple of these had got this x equal to 6? What would have happened, right? Would that x equal to 6 have been committed or not, right, by the system? Okay, so you might want to work out different examples. I've looked at a couple of them, right? But Raft essentially uses these two rules in order to make things work, and you can ensure that you have safety with these two. Okay, so safety means that essentially once an input is committed, it's always committed. Once input is committed by leader, then it is always committed by future leaders. So let's look at the state diagram of the election procedure in some detail. So let's say that a node starts up and it immediately becomes a follower and sets some timer value. It will choose some timer value from some maybe large range, but it will choose it randomly. We'll see why that is the case. Okay, so the follower is going to decrement this timer value. Okay, and he checks, have I heard a heartbeat or not from the current leader? Okay, so the leader is sending out heartbeats continuously, and if he has heard a heartbeat, then of course he resets that timer. Let's say he chooses another random value, right? And in that particular, so this keeps going on, and let's say that the leader stops sending heartbeats because the leader has failed. Okay, so let's look at the case. Eventually, suppose this particular node's timer expires, okay, and he hasn't heard a heartbeat before that timer has expired, then he becomes a candidate and he's going to increment his local variable, the term variable, to one higher than what it was. Okay, and before he announces his candidature, he first checks, have I got a request to vote from somebody else? It's possible that somebody else has already become a candidate and has announced it. So then why create confusion if you know that you also announce your candidature? So if you have got a request from somebody else, then you look whether your own prefix, your own log is a prefix of the other candidate's log, which he has announced. And if yes, then you can vote for that node. Okay, and then you go back to the follower state. But suppose nobody else has volunteered to become candidate, you haven't heard from somebody else, then what you can do is you can vote for yourself, sort of, right? You count your own vote and then you announce your candidature. So you say that I'm requesting everybody to vote for me, and you also share your log with everybody, right? So that they can check whether indeed their log is a prefix of yours.
So if after this you have received a majority of votes, then you become the leader and then you start sending heartbeats after that. Suppose you have not received the majority of the notes, majority of the votes. Let's say there is, so you set some timer in order to count the number of votes. And if you haven't received majority of the votes till then you go back and you become a follower after that. Okay. So of course there are a few other things that can happen. Many different things can happen. We only looked at certain possibilities. So of course if let's say that you have heard from somebody else, you haven't announced your own candidature, right? But your own log was not a prefix of that candidate's log, right? Then you could announce your own candidature in that case, right? And you can vote for yourself and then announce your own candidature. Okay, so there are of course certain other cases that maybe a few cases which I haven't considered at all, but one other case is that when you are a follower itself, you might hear that somebody else has announced a term which is higher, right, for whatever reason, and we are assuming that all nodes are honest, there is no dishonest node over here. So if somebody has announced his candidature with a term higher than the term that I have locally, okay, that means he is sort of announcing that he wants to become leader, then you check whether you are eligible to vote for him. If your log is a prefix of his, if it is, then you can vote for that node, right? So this is not a extensive complete flowchart which I have shown. The complete flowchart will be quite more complicated than this, but it does look at most of the situations when somebody, let's say a leader, has stopped sending heartbeats, for example, and in that case somebody would either you yourself would become a candidate, or you hear from somebody else who has decided to become a candidate, and then the new leader is elected, right? So it may happen that like we looked at in the previous slide, that somebody who does not have the appropriate state volunteers to become a leader, in which case he doesn't get majority of the votes, and then the term is incremented and somebody else is eventually elected to be the leader. Okay, so these rules of RAFT ensure that safety is taken care of, that once a leader has committed something, that we are ensured that a future leader has that appropriate state. Okay. So what about availability? That's something which hasn't been discussed too much in the paper, but they do say under what conditions they have availability. So availability is essentially liveness. Okay, so availability means that when a client is going to send an input, that input will be accepted by whoever is the new leader. Okay, it shouldn't be that the system is dead and that it doesn't accept new inputs. So let's say that new inputs are accepted and let's say eventually committed. So when is this going to be held? Okay, so actually there's a technical definition. Let me just give it to you. Given in the paper. So the replicated state machine is fully functional as long as any majority of servers are operational, operational and can communicate with each other and the client. Okay, so we say that the system is available if it behaves like a single server. Okay, so the client sends something to the server and it gets the appropriate reply. So that's fully functional. Okay, and that should, we say that we want, we ensure availability, okay, that it's fully functional, okay, as long as any majority of the servers is operational and can communicate with each other to the client, okay. So Raft should guarantee this, and when is this true? So for Raft, Raft is available. If so, the broadcast time so this is the time to broadcast a message into the network, right? In order to, let's say one the leader sends a message to the other node, this is the broadcast time, the time in which everybody will get the message. If this is much smaller, okay, this is order of magnitude. Less than the election timeout that they use. Okay, so this broadcast, I mean, you have to send out heartbeats, right? And the broadcast time is the time for the heartbeat to reach everybody else. Okay, so the broadcast time is much less than the election timeout. Okay, so this is the timeout. If somebody does not hear a heartbeat, then he will sort of become a candidate. Okay, so that is this timeout variable. And if this is much less than the average time between failure events, okay, this is true, then according to the authors of the paper, their system will be available. Okay, so I didn't see any proof of this in the main paper at least. So mainly the paper focuses on the safety aspects. Okay, so we've looked at Raft. So even though it has a very simple model, we should say there are only n servers in the system. It's not a permissionless system like Satoshi, right? There are only n servers, and we have a very simple failure model of they just fail stop, that nobody is malicious, but just a node can go down and fail. And in that case, we see that we have a somewhat complicated algorithm. At least there are two main rules which we have to follow. But if those rules are followed, the authors prove that they guarantee safety, meaning that if a leader has committed a particular input locally and updated the state machine locally, then we are guaranteed that even if that leader fails and a new leader is elected, then that new leader will have this state, the state which was committed by the former leader. Okay, and of course, if the timers are set appropriately, then we have availability to the system. Because if some of these do not hold, then you can imagine that you may have a system where you only have leader elections. Okay, that no leader actually does any useful information. You will have the term just keep incrementing, and there's a continuous election process. Okay. But if the timers are set appropriately, so the election timeout should be set smaller than the average time between failures, okay, and the broadcast time should be much less than the selection timeout, that in this case the system would be available, that it will actually accept inputs from the client and will send appropriate replies, right? So quite a tricky protocol, tricky algorithm and protocol to for even a simple system, right? But distributed systems are complicated, and as we will see in future lectures, when we look at PBFT, it looks at a much more difficult threat model where the nodes can be actually malicious. So they can send, they can lie, they can do things like, you know, tell one thing to somebody else and tell something else contradictory to somebody else, right? So PBFT is a much more complicated protocol than Raft. We'll look at it next. And we'll see, and compared to all these protocols, if you look at Satoshi's protocol, it's extremely simple and it works in a much more difficult situation where you have a permissionless setting, right? But of course Satoshi's method has some problems. We saw it consumes a huge amount of energy, and actually if you think about it, Satoshi never guarantees safety because forks are always possible. He just guarantees that with some low probability you have safety. Okay, the meaning that if your transaction is deep enough in the chain, then with very high probability it will remain there forever. Okay, but there is no 100% guarantee which you get, unlike in something like Raft or PBFT. Okay, so these protocols which look for permissioned systems, they actually give you 100% guarantee that under these settings, that safety will never be violated at all.